So I've made a number of videos that look at ways to recover from an error in your 24-word seed phrase, but the really good thing about these tools like BTCRecover is they can also help you to recover from an error in your passphrase. So this can happen when you've typed in your recovery phrase, it's correct, it's right, but then you notice that your wallet is spitting out a whole bunch of addresses that don't seem to quite line up with where your crypto should be, and there's no transactions or anything like that lining up with it. And you might be thinking to yourself, oh no, because you'd written down your recovery phrase, but you'd relied on the fact that you'd remember your passphrase. And, you know, this is actually a really easy mistake to make. And this is one of the reasons why both Ledger and Trezor warn users that adding a passphrase to their recovery phrase is an advanced feature, because it's easy to forget. And it's an easy mistake to make in that some wallets, like Electrum, don't even ask you to type in your passphrase twice. So if you're just in a hurry and working in Electrum, it's entirely possible you could just have a typo in your passphrase and send the funds to the wrong place and not realize you'd made that mistake for months and months and months. And I'm going to make a number of videos as to some really easy ways to make sure that you're validating your passphrase before you start loading those up with crypto. There's some important notes to start. And firstly, you will need a correct 24-word seed for this tool to work in the way that I'm going to demonstrate here today. You also need to know at least one public address that was used with your wallet. So basically, what this does is it looks at a variety, it tests a whole bunch of different passphrases, and it's looking for this public address that you've listed. So let's say, for example, like I have in my other videos, we purchased some Ethereum on Coinbase, and we remember we sent it to this address. So that's the address we're going to use. So firstly, you need to download the repository for the SegWit fork of BTCRecover. I cover this in another video. The link will be in the description to both my original video and this repository that I'll use. So you're going to need to set up an air-gapped Ubuntu 18.04 environment, which is covered in my previous video on this. So if you watch it for about the 12 and a bit minutes to 21 minutes, you get step-by-step instructions on how to do that. You can run this stuff directly in Windows if you're feeling that desperate, and the whole idea of using Linux is too confronting. So that's something we can do. And, you know, alternatively, if there is enough demand, so, you know, say 10 or so people request it in the comments, or someone decides to sponsor it, I can also update and distribute an amnesic Linux distribution with these crypto tools prepackaged. So like a live USB that you can just boot, that'll have all this stuff baked in. So once we've loaded up our air-gapped Ubuntu environment, we have two options to use BTCRecover to recover a passphrase. Firstly, we can use a password list file. In my opinion, a password list is really easy to understand and a really good place to start. So that's where we're going to start. So password list is good to use if you think you have a pretty good idea as to what your password was, or maybe you've got a few options for passwords you might have used, but you think you maybe made a typo in there somewhere. So basically how this works is you create a list of passwords that you think it was. You will also need to add any likely spelling mistakes that you might have made, because it won't go trying to add in extra letters for you. So for example, this file might, password file might have like 6 rows in it. So I've actually done a common misspelling of Ethereum there that I often see online as well. You know, maybe you weren't sure which year it was and you thought, oh, maybe it was one of those two as well. So, you know, our file would have these 6 rows in it. And you can make password files that are quite long, because basically increasing the size of your password file will give you a linear increase in computation time. So what that means is if you double the number of passwords in your password list file, it will take twice as long. And that's quite different to the token file, which we'll look at later. So this is why I suggest that even a long list of potential passwords might be a better approach than trying to use a token list, just because it's really easy to understand what you're doing. And it decreases the chance that you're going to make a mistake and have BTCRecover do something that says it's going to take, you know, days and weeks when it turns out you might have made a mistake in the token file. The other thing that you can use is called a token list file. And that's where you might remember parts of your password, or let's say blocks of letters and words that make up a large password. And, you know, this can work really well if you have like a small number of tokens that your password's going to be made up of. But once your list starts getting longer, you might need more. So for example, our token file might include the following lines. because we remember that we would often use these different characters to make up passwords. But the issue is that for it just to test all possible combinations of these, including all typo variations, it would be working on a password this long. And that would require thousands of years. So to use the token file, we need to help it out, and we can give it instructions to know roughly where we think these words should go. So we might remember that our password started probably with one of these three words. So start with, you know, Ethereum or Bitcoin. You know, we might remember that it would have ended with one of these years, and that maybe we had this symbol somewhere in between these other tokens. So doing that significantly decreases the amount of possible password combinations that a token file will produce, and it makes it quite manageable to recover even some fairly long and potentially complex passwords if you, say, have a habit of like stringing different passwords or different sets of words together. But this is the point, is the documentation for how to do a token file can get quite complex. It is well documented on BTCRecover, but I won't spend time on going into the complex details of how to intricately craft a token file, because that is just way beyond the level of complexity that I think is helpful to deal with here. And, you know, something like forums, Reddit, or the comment section is a much better place for that. So my suggested workflow for this is firstly that you create a secure environment to run the tool. I also suggest that you get the tool working and test it with one of these scenarios that I'm going to go through here below, just so that you can make sure you're getting the syntax right and you can be confident that you understand how the tool works before putting your own real information in there. I'd suggest you start with a password list and only move on to a token list if you don't have success with that first password list. Okay, so our first example is going to be looking for what's basically the first address on the default derivation path. So I've got the phrase that we're using. I've got the actual passphrase. You can see there it's got a typo in it. And we're going to be looking for the first address in the first account on the default derivation path, and that's this one right here. We're going to be using a password file that's this one here. It just has one word in it, one line. That's it. Our best memory of it was that it was this, and the command we're going to use to find that is this one here. So basically what we've got, I've basically put in a lot of different options here that I think are going to give you the best chance of finding it first go. So we're going to check for a typo assuming we had caps lock on. We're going to check for a typo assuming we swapped some letters. Maybe we accidentally hit one of the letters twice. Maybe we accidentally left one out. Maybe we had one letter capitalized or not. We're going to look for a maximum of three typos. And we're also going to use this typo map here, which what it does is it's for if you accidentally hit a letter next to one of the ones in the passphrase. We're looking at the default BIP32 path, and our wallet type is Ethereum. Our address generation limit is just one, because we're only looking at the first address. So we'll just run that. So it's asking us to enter the extended public key. We don't have that. We have one address. And we want our best guess of the phrase. Well, we know what the right phrase is, so we'll put that in there. And there we go. So it's working. And there we go. So that found it in about 30 seconds. It found the password, UTUB. So we now know that the correct passphrase is UTUB, so we can start using that. So I'll move on to a second example, and that is a longer password, and we're going to have a longer password list too. So this is actually going to use a different passphrase, which means that all of the addresses it generates will be different for the test. So we're going to be looking for this address here. And you know, we think the password was Ethereum 2019, so we'll use this password file here. And I've also added in, you know, let's think, oh, maybe I misspelled Ethereum when I was doing it. I wasn't sure which year it was, and oh, maybe I used one of these Bitcoin-style addresses too. So we'll just stick all of those variants in there. We're going to use this command here, and the only real difference for this one is that we're using a different password file. So that's this one here. It's going to be the same phrase. We don't have an XPub file. The address we're looking for is this one, which is different to the one we used in the last example. We know our seed, which is this. Then we hit go. This one is going to take a little while longer, So this one's a good one where, you know, it's time to go and get yourself a coffee. All right, so we can see it found it, and there you go. So obviously we'd misspelled Ethereum, and oh, whoops, it was 2018, not 2019, and no capitalization. So it found it, and took about 11 minutes, but it could have taken an hour if it had had to go all the way to the end, so that's great. So let's also have a look at what it would look like to do basically the same recovery, but to use a token list. So this was a more advanced way of doing it, and this token list here will give us a very similar password list to this. Obviously it would include more, because you know everything could potentially have an at in it, but you know, it's just an easy way to chain together lots of blocks of a password. So this time we're also going to be using the 10th address. So say we couldn't remember what the first address was, we're going to be using the 10th address. And that's particularly common for things like Bitcoin that increment the address every time. But for things like Ethereum, that might mean that on, say, my Ether wallet, you would have scrolled through, say, the first couple of pages of addresses and then selected the 10. So perhaps you're using the first 9 for different things. And my video on my Ether wallet talks about that. It's also going to be coming from a different derivation path. So if you have Ledger Live or something like that, it talks about different accounts, and every time you add an account in Ledger Live, it changes the derivation path, and that's important because the derivation path is used in this tool. We're using the same password from example 2, but yes, we're looking for a different address. This command is the same as what we had before, but you'll notice this time we've set the address limit, generation limit, to 20, because we're not just after the first address. We're also setting the derivation path to this, so M44601. The other thing that's important to note is that increasing the address limit to 20 actually doesn't take 20 times longer. So, you know, doubling the number of addresses you're generating from 10 to 20 will actually only increase the processing time by about 20%. So if in doubt, particularly if you're using a coin like Bitcoin that gives you a new receiving address every time you go to receive coins, you know, just set this address limit to be, say, you know, 10, 20, or even 50. It won't increase the processing time enormously, so it's a good thing to do. So for in this example, we're doing 20, and we're using the token file that is this one here. So it's using this tokens positional.txt. So here we go. We don't have an xpub file in these examples. The address we're looking for is this one. And the seed we know that is correct is this one here. So again, this is the point where you grab your Bitcoin mug, go and get a coffee. If you're wondering where my cute Bitcoin mug came from, it was a gift from my wife, and you can just get them on Amazon. So if you'd like one of them, there'll be a link in the description. So that's just finished running now, and you'll notice it's dark behind me. It took a bit longer to run, and the reason is that I actually made a typo up here, in that I put in the wrong derivation path. So I fixed my notes, and they will be correct in the description for the video, but I didn't notice that I'd had that error until I'd been running for 2 hours. So I fixed it up, ran it again, and off we go. And as you can see, it found the phrase just the same as with the password list, and it only took about 10 minutes to do it, and a full run would have taken about 3 hours. So there we go. And I think that's also just a really good example that it's really important that you have things like your derivation path right, because again, it's very easy to make a typo that'll just have this do a full run that might take hours and hours and find nothing. Hey, look, I hope that's been helpful in helping you to recover from an error in your passphrase. And as you can see here, it's something that is definitely doable to recover. At the same time, this should probably also be a good reminder and a good illustration that a short passphrase in addition to your 24-word seed is on its own not an invincible level of security. So even though you have a passphrase, you still need to keep your 24-word seed secure. But other than that, give us a yell if you've got any other questions or queries with this example. So best of luck. Thanks for watching. I hope that was helpful. Just hit subscribe if you'd like to be kept in the loop about future content I make to help people stay safe in the crypto space and to recover if they get into trouble. Or if there's a question you'd like some more information about, or a topic you'd like me to cover in the future, just leave a reply.